Allah, Brahma, ultimate Brahma, whatever names we want to give, we want to call that ultimate power whom we consider as our origin and our goal with some name. The question is whether it is important what name we give to the Lord. In one of the religious texts in India, one master has said, you can give as many names to the Lord as you like. And thereafter he proceeds to list the names that he thinks would be appropriate and proceeds to write out about 1,500 names for the Lord. And says, any one of them is good enough, so long as you understand who you are referring to. In every religion, in every country, we find that there are different names used to describe the Lord. And somehow, the original message of those spiritual masters who came and delivered them to us are lost in the quarrels and rivalries over names, the spoken names of the Lord. I had an opportunity once to attend a congress of religions and different spiritual organizations and cults in India. A number of these different denominations, religions and cults were represented at that meeting. And speaking to them, I said, when I discuss your religion, your principles of finding truth, your concepts of truth and God, I find that you have only two things in common. The rest are all different. One common thing is that your founder gave the same message in all religions. Namely, the Lord is within you, go and find him there. The kingdom of God is within you. This was a common message that they all gave. And you fortunately still retain it. After that you have changed everything else. And you say, no, this is not right. They don't know the right thing, we know the right thing. The only other common thing which all religions and cults have is that each one says, we alone know the right way. This again is common to all of them. So they all claim, we know there's only one God. There now no two. They all say there's only one for all of them. And we only know the way to the Lord. And the way we call the Lord and give a name is the real name. Others are not the real name. And our record or scripture or holy book or holy writ contains the real name. All others are unreal names. They are not right. They are fake. Everyone says the same thing. It's so common. Now what is the real name? Can you suggest some real name of God which everybody should accept? St. John's Gospel says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Shall we say that the Word is an appropriate name for God? The Muslims say, not the Muslims, their Prophet says. Their Prophet Muhammad says that Allah created the world and all this creation through His Word, the Kalma, and the Kalma is the Lord. Kalma represents the creation, Creator. Shall we then say the Kalma or the Word is an appropriate name for the Lord? The Hindus say that there was no creation at the point of origin except when the great Word was spoken, the Nad or the Om. The Word created the universe, the Word was the Creator. Shall we then say, according to Hindus, that the Word is the name of God? If you go into smaller cults and religions, you'll be surprised. The Subud society says Subud is the creator. Subud is literally in Sanskrit means the word. Shabud or Subud means the word. The latest religion which has become militant recently of the Sikhs, their holy book says that the Shabud or the word created this entire universe. Now, what strikes me as extraordinary is that every religion of the world and of every country should use a word called the Word to describe the Lord. If they are using the Word to describe the Lord, why is it so? Why are they using the Word? Obviously, because if they don't use the word, they will have to use too many words. In place of so many words and names, they've chosen to use the word. They call it the word because it is audible. I mentioned yesterday that the Lord Himself is audible. He does not speak in spoken words. If He spoke in the spoken words in which I am speaking to you, or which are written in books, any books, if He spoke in those words, He would become a limited God. He would become a God of those words. If He is unlimited, infinite, absolute, He cannot speak in a few limited words. He does not, and yet He speaks. He speaks all the time to us. He speaks in unlimited words, unspoken words. And since they are unspoken and unlimited, we call it the Word. In fact, when He speaks in the unspoken word, that is He Himself. His own form and expression is the Word. We call it the unspoken word because we cannot speak it. Every language of the world consists of spoken and written words. Every language. There is no language that does not have spoken and written words. Therefore, no language represents the word that God speaks, or the word that is God. You cannot put Him down in language. Then what is that languageless, audible power that we call God, or the ultimate reality, or absolute truth? When perfect masters and oriental mystics used to initiate their disciples, and they still do in the same way, they point out that there are two kinds of words, the spoken word and the unspoken word. And they say the spoken word can be used in writing, reading, speaking. And we have used these words to describe the Lord for thousands of years. And all the words that we use in the spoken language to refer to God are the spoken names of the Lord. But there is a word which cannot be spoken. It cannot come in writing. It cannot be read. What is that word which cannot be spoken, cannot be written down, cannot be read, and yet can be heard? That is the existence of the current of consciousness that proceeds from the Lord and pervades through ourself wherever we might be. Whatever level of consciousness we might be at, that current, vibration, resonance, consciousness, the stream of consciousness, which is audible, pervades through us at all levels. It is this audible life stream or life current, audible consciousness current, which we can hear, that is called the unspoken word or the nameless name of the Lord. We can hear it, but we can't name it. What does it represent? It represents the original music, a music that cannot be written down. It represents a resonance and a melody which cannot be put down into notes. Yet it is a resonance and melody. When you experience that melody at any level, even in the grossest level in the physical body, and it exists in everyone behind the eyes, it exists in holy men, saints, mystics, masters, thieves, robbers, gangsters, good men, bad men, immoral men, moral men, it exists behind the eyes of every human being and can be heard there. This resonance or sound is unlike any other sound that you have heard, and yet it is a sound. All other sounds are heard with our eardrums. This sound is heard with our spirit, our attention, our consciousness. This sound is heard by itself. The very sound, the very consciousness it represents is able to hear it. It is a self audible sound. That means the sound listens to itself. It does not require any external aid whatsoever. Whether you are deaf or dumb, or whether you have any ears or don't have any ears, you can hear it. You hear it by being with it. Unlike other sounds, even if you make a lot of noise, I find the young kids now buying these stereo sets, and they want to see that it plays very loud, and that there should be no cracking of the sound of the bongo drums, even if they are played very loud. Even the loudest I have seen, I have tried to see the loudest of these bongo drums. They do not have the intensity and loudness which this sound has, which is within us. And yet you can't say it is merely a sound. Because when you hear it, it resounds like a vibration, as if it is giving you all the energy, life, consciousness that you possess. Also, when you are listening to that sound, the nameless sound within you, it gives you the experience of being with a conscious being, as if it is itself conscious. Indeed it is. It is not a sound which consciousness has to pick up. It is consciousness itself. Therefore it is like a being. You almost enjoy its company like you would enjoy the company of a person who is conscious. It's like a friend. Not only that, when you hear that sound within, you will see that the sound itself is creating all the experiences that you have ever had. It is the creator. There can be no experience outside but for the vibration and resonance of that sound within us. This remarkable sound or audible consciousness or audible stream of life that is flowing through all of us is the secret by which we can travel up on a spiritual journey. All other meditations fail when we go beyond a certain point. This one does not. In all other types of meditation, we have to make an effort to reach behind the eyes at the third eye center, go above into higher regions of consciousness, try to vacate the body, try to detach ourselves, try to attach somewhere else, put in efforts to achieve some results. All types of meditation require that, except listening to the sound of yourself within. It requires no effort. It pulls you like nothing else can pull you. If you were to go to the point behind the eyes where you can hear this reverberation of this sound, it pulls you, draws you, makes you vacate your body in a few seconds. And all the meditation looks so futile compared to this. Therefore, sometimes the highest spiritual masters, the perfect masters, have described the listening to this sound as the highest form of yoga, the ultimate yoga. And they called it the Surta Shabda Yoga, which means the yoga of the attention and the sound. To fix attention on the sound and reach the higher realms of consciousness is considered the highest yoga known to human being. Therefore, the real name of God is that nameless sound which is within us. And true meditation consists of linking our attention to that sound and rising along with it. Is there any resemblance of that sound to any other sound that we have heard? Can we identify it? Yes, we can. When we sit quietly, we hear many sounds within ourselves. Even if you try to do a simple meditation of just trying to relax, you can hear the physical sounds of your breathing, your heartbeat, the movement of blood in the blood vessels, even the movement of lymphatic fluids in the lymphatic vessels. You can hear the sha sha kind of sounds and some rhythmic beats which are rising from the heart. These sounds are very easy. You begin to hear them because your attention is concentrated. But as you raise your level of awareness behind the eyes and listen intently, you hear different sounds. The son of Tabriz, Shams Tabriz, the great mystic from the Middle East, in Persia, he says in Persian, Khamosh panj nobat bishnoz is asmani. If you are willing to keep quiet, you can hear five melodies up in the sky. What it means is, if you are willing to listen in, keep quiet means don't let your mind speak too much. If you can quieten your mind, you can hear five beautiful melodies resounding within. What are those melodies? And why five? Other mystics and masters of the higher orders have also said there are five distinct melodies which can be associated with the sound that reverberates with our own self. When we practice listening to our own sound, we first encounter some sounds which are not really spiritual, but they are very interesting. The more we concentrate behind the eyes, we begin to see light and sound. As the light increases, the sound increases. Sometimes the light comes first and the sound follows. Sometimes the sound comes first and the light follows. The reason is that our attention, which is not linked to sensory perceptions, continues to possess the powers of seeing and listening. The power to see is called nirat in Sanskrit, and the power to listen is called surat. Surat and nirat, the power to listen and the power to see, continue through spiritual experiences and spiritual journeys to higher worlds and higher realms. They do not occur together. One may come first and the other may come later. But they are experiencing the same thing. When you experience that sound through nirat, through the power to see, it looks like a very bright light. Before you see the big, white, bright light, you may see smaller versions of it, including colored versions, like colored waterfalls, as if there is crimson colored, purple colored, orange colored, large waterfall falling from mountains. You can have these visions, which are also the reflected visions of the same sound within. Or you can start listening to sounds representing these colors, like the sounds of chirping of birds, like the sound of crickets continuously making a particular sound, or the sound of a train continuously passing over a railroad bridge, or the sound of thunder in the distance, or sound of small bells ringing in the distance. These are the sounds which we can all hear if we concentrate behind the eyes. They are all occurring at physical level, but when we concentrate within ourselves, they do not represent, they don't have the power to pull us. These sounds can be heard. If we attend to them, we hear them. And they are like an orchestra. Supposing an orchestra is playing here and you want to hear a drum, you put your attention on the drum will become louder and the other musical instruments will become slower, although no change has been made. Your attention can pick up one sound from the others. Or if you want to listen to the piano notes, the drums may keep on playing. You concentrate on the piano notes, eventually you will hear the piano notes more clearly and loudly compared to the other notes. Attention can pick up these sounds. Similarly, when you concentrate your attention within, behind the eyes, you have the ability to pick up certain sounds. As you go over these various sounds, you are advised to pick up the sound of the small bells ringing in the distance. Because these small bells are linked with the real sound of bells, which is the basic sound that you hear in the stream of consciousness. Therefore, when you pick out these small ringing bells inside and stay with them and avoid listening to the other sounds, these little bells will lead to the listening as if in the distance of the big bells, as if they are church bells. Many people, during their initial stages of practice of this kind of meditation of the audible life stream, have got up to see if the real church bells are ringing. And there was nothing, no sound outside. But they were so loud, they couldn't believe that this was happening within themselves. When you leave your attention from the little bells and move on to the big bell, the big gongs that are going on, the little bells, they make ting, ting, ting kind of sound. But the big gong that follows them, if you keep your attention there, is like dong, dong, with that big resonance. And when you hear that, it looks like it is pulling you. When you cannot hear any other sound but the big bell, you find a strange pull towards the bell. It picks you up as if it's a human being carrying you in its arms. This sound of the bell within us is really the Lord Himself stretching its arms to take us. It looks like a bell sound. It is not bell sound. In relation to our level of consciousness, it comes and looks like the bell sound. It was heard by all the mystics, all the masters of all the religions all over the world. Therefore, they put it down in all the churches, all the houses of God, all the temples, all the mosques. This is the bell that is always with us, within us. This is the church. This is the temple. We are carrying with us. This head that we carry is the real temple, the real church, in which the real bells are ringing all the time. They never stop. 24 hours. And they call us. It's a call to us. When we copied this church symbolically to remind people, don't forget this real purpose of life. The real purpose of life is not to just live, eat, drink, be merry and die like animals. That we have done for a long time. The real purpose of life is now to raise consciousness to divine levels, to perfection. And therefore, we must move onwards to give a symbolic call that we must rise in our consciousness. They copied this part of the body, which was the church. The whole body was not. The whole body was never the temple or the church. This was the church, this part. So they made the domes, and they made the steeples like the headwear people used to wear. They made it just like people, their head, this head portion looked like, they put it down on the ground and called it a church or a temple or a mosque or a house of worship. Everywhere, in every religion, throughout the world. And they put the light and the sound in all these places, lest we forget what we are going to see when we go in here. And they gave discourses and sermons inside those places to remind us further that the real church temple is in the body. Go within. But so great was our misfortune that we forgot that those buildings were symbolic. They were messages to us. We listened to the sermons while looking at each other, thinking of our other work which we had to do immediately after service, and forgot what the message was, and thought that by coming to that symbolic place, we had done our duty by God, and we must have made one step closer to Him. We never moved into the church for which there were symbols. And yet, the bell sound which pulls us is only an indication, a call, that you are on the right track. It is not the final sound. Indeed, it is not a sound of bells at all. Looks like the sound of bells. It comes to us in peals like bells. Gong, gong, gong. It looks like bells that sound within, with a strong vibration and pull and attraction. And its melody cannot be compared with any melody of music. It pulls you, it's attractive. It's a strange music. And if you listen to it, what happens? When you listen to it, it picks you up. And then you realize that these different peals of the bell, the feeling that it is saying gong, gong on periodical, is not real. And they elongate. These peals of the bell sound, they elongate. Instead of being gong, gong, they become gong, gong. Ultimately, when you keep on with the attraction and pull of the sound, then each one of the peals becomes long enough to last your entire meditation. And you can ride one peal on for the entire period. 1 hour, 2 hours, 1 day, 2 days. At that stage, you cannot call it a bell at all. You forget that these were the peals of the bell. You have now gone on to that part, that form, expression of the sound, which sometimes they say is the second sound. Actually, it's the same sound. But it's no longer a bell. So how do you describe it? Then they start saying, it's like the blowing of a conch, it's like a horn, and they give other descriptions to it. As you rise in awareness, further refinements take place, and then we start describing it as like the flute. And we say it sounds like a flute. Very, very melodious. When a flute is played, people say this is meditational music. And immediately creates an atmosphere as if we are in a state of worship, in a state of meditation. Especially flute with a long play with a little vibration to show it's a flute. When it's played like that, we call it the mystic or the meditational music. Over here, symbolically. When you hear this very music converted to flute, you rise above into higher levels of consciousness. In fact, you need no meditation except rising along the sound current if you want to go to higher levels of consciousness. Therefore, at every level you will find the same sound pulling you up. The sound looks different because it passes through different levels of creation and different levels of our own experience and consciousness. Sound does not change. We feel it changes. Just like we feel the other experience changes. We look at people here and they look very beautiful, multicolored. We can see them in nice forms. When we raise our consciousness behind the eyes and open the inner eyes, we see the same people with light emanating from them. We can see them even when we put off all these lights, which we hadn't experienced here. But they are the same people. We are seeing them with different eyes. When we raise our consciousness further, the same world with our eyes open can be seen looking much more bright. Completely different. The world is not changing. We are passing through different regions of consciousness. Therefore, it looks different. In the same way, this strange sound emanating from our own true self, which is the expression of ourself, this strange sound seems to change along with the levels of consciousness, although it continues to be the same one single sound. And this sound represents the Lord Himself. Just like a river flows through valleys and mountains and cascades and makes different sound, but the river is the same. In the same way, consciousness flows through different levels of experience and creates different sounds of itself. It does not mean the river has changed, it's a new river. It's the same river, but the environment it passes through, the experience it passes through, makes it sound different. The other day, I stood outside a river, just on the bank of a river with some friends. We went to have a meal in a restaurant on the side of a river. And when we were looking at the river, somebody said, "Isn't it wonderful how nice it feels to be near a river?" And I said, "Nice? If one wants to learn the spiritual truth, one can learn it just by a visit to the river. Needn't go anywhere else." In Hermann Hesse's book called Siddhartha, you will find he has described the journey of Siddhartha Gautam, who later became the Buddha, into many regions to find truth. He can't find in the forest, he can't find in meditation, he can't find in salvation, he can't find in nirvana. Ultimately, he goes and tries to cross a river on a ferry, and there is a wise old mystic sitting there. And he tells the mystic, "I want to cross the river." The mystic says, "What for?" He says, "I am going to the other side to find truth." The mystic says, "You can find the truth on this side of the river as well as on the other side." He said, "What has the river got to do with it?" He says, "I got my knowledge and truth from the river." And the disciple says, "Tell me, how could you get knowledge from the river?" He said, "Come with me, I will tell you how you can get your total knowledge from a river." So they both stand on the bank of the river, and the mystic tells the disciple, "Watch carefully. At no time will you see the same water in front of you. The water is changing continuously, it's flowing all the time. There is no moment when the water stops, it's flowing all the time. And yet the river is the same and doesn't change at all. And what is the river? The same water which is flowing. Can you imagine that something is flowing and changing all the time and yet remains completely unchanged? This is the story of our real self. The consciousness that flows through experience changes all the time. Change brings experience. And yet the consciousness that is creating the experience remains unchanged. If you can truly understand this river, you will understand the truth." This is a beautiful analogy he gave. Because this consciousness is God and never changes and never flows. And yet the experience of this consciousness flows, creates time, creates a movement, creates change, creates all the worlds and all the regions that we know of. Therefore, if we travel backwards on this consciousness, from the flow and experience of this consciousness, we can come to the totality of this consciousness which has never changed and doesn't flow, which is God Himself. So the nameless name of the Lord consists of this audible expression which is available to us at all times, even now while we are in this state. If we could barely keep quiet, that means if we could make our minds keep quiet, we would listen to that sound instantly. It does not take any time. The moment you quieten your mind, the sound will be visible and you will find what that Lord is. You will hear the Lord, but you may not use any name. That indeed is the nameless name of the Lord. Thank you very much. Any questions? I shall be very happy to answer. Yes. Yes, you are right. There is always a label which we attach even to the nameless. So we give a name to the nameless, and the Lord has always proclaimed himself when he has come. He may proclaim himself in any manner. So I would agree with your observation that you have made, that this has always happened. But I don't think that we could really fix any particular label for all times for the Lord. I sometimes think of an analogy of a mother and her child, and I find that the mother who loves her child more calls her by more names perhaps than the one who doesn't love the child. She calls her by the given name. And this names given in fondness appear to have no relation to the given name, what they call pet names and darling names and so on. In India, you know, sometimes the mothers use abusive language for the children out of love. And it's very strange, but they may say, you may die. There's a certain expression. And nobody wants the child to die. But even that they say, and it is taken as a word of endearment. So the understanding is that whatever name or label you give to affection and love becomes the name of that love. So we have given labels to the Lord, and we'll keep on giving. And when the Lord expresses himself in human form, we still give labels. But there is no one label that we can fix for all times.
In other words, if you give a name, really, it's a finite thing that
we limit. That's right. You give a name, you make it finite and limited. How can you limit something that is unlimited? Yes.
The purpose of life is to raise consciousness to the divine level.
Yes.
Is consciousness God? How do you feel about things already at a divine level?
We use this word consciousness in two senses. One is in the sense of total consciousness, which is God. And we also use the word consciousness in the sense of awareness. If you are conscious of a thing, you are aware of a thing. So when we say raised level of consciousness, we talk of raising levels of awareness. Yes?
Can you take the role of the master?
The role of the master is when he initiates, he joins our attention within, behind the eyes, with the sound current. So that when we withdraw, we hear the sound straight away, without effort. This is called initiation. Initiation is the linking of the attention of the seeker with that sound current behind the eyes forever. So that when the seeker just withdraws behind the eyes, the sound picks him up. Unlike other meditations where a perfect master has not done it, the seeker has to keep on concentrating, withdrawing attention from one level to another, and may reach one, two levels or not. But through this, the perfect master ensures that you ride the vehicle of the sound current right to the top. The second association of the master is that this sound current is the real form of the master, of which he is a human expression. When you go within and find that you have been linked to the sound current and you see the same form of the master, as you ride the sound current, you find this was the master. And it's been the same master at all times, in everybody, throughout history. Only the expressions outside changed. Because we were not linked with the inner sound current, so different human forms came out outside to guide us within. Yes.
If the perfect living master initiates someone in contact with sound and light is made, and then lost, who follows?
When the contact is made by a living master, it is never lost. Never. Not even if both of them die in their physical bodies. It does happen that during the course of our practice of going within, our attention is not sufficiently withdrawn, and we sometimes seem to hear the sound, we don't hear the sound. Then we again hear the sound, we don't hear the sound. It is just like sometimes we see the light, sometimes we don't see the light. Light is not disappearing, nor is the sound waning or waxing. It is our own attention that is fluctuating. And therefore, when our attention gets fixed within, then the sound and the light never disappear. Since there are no more questions, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.